Welcome back to Bumps and Burpees. I'm joined again by Claire. Claire Bourne is a women's health physio and also pregnant with her second baby.
Can you tell?
How far along are you now?
I'm 26 weeks.
Okay.
Yes, I was yesterday. It's terrible with the number two. I've been much like 20 something.
Yeah, but the first one you were like, and 5 days.
Yeah.
So I thought Claire's had quite an interesting journey through her pregnancies. And so I thought it'd be a good thing today to get her to come and talk about it, because I'm sure a lot of people think that women's health physios just like have it all figured out.
Yeah.
You must get that a lot. And so I just wanted, it's just nice to hear people's stories. And so you can maybe relate to some part of it or, So, tell me about your first pregnancy, because we met when you were already pregnant,
Yeah, the journey to that.
Yeah, exactly. So how did you get to that stage?
Yeah. So in my early 20s, I think I was around 23 or something, I got diagnosed with something called hypothalamic amenorrhea.
That is an mouthful.
It just rolls off the tongue. So amenorrhea is basically like you don't have periods. So I'd had this time in my life, I'd had quite a stressful time, I had to break up of a relationship.
Okay.
I think I'd changed jobs, you know, was moving house, you know, classic things you do in your early 20s. And I'd noticed that my periods had become more erratic, but I'd never really been one to track periods because I just always had them. So I just didn't bother. And then I started being like, maybe I haven't had a period for like 3 months. And I was like, maybe that's not normal. And then they sort of stopped altogether. I'd gone travelling for like a month. So I was like, oh, it's just the travelling.
You always make excuses.
There's always an excuse. But it'd been about a year and I was like, and I started having like weird like flushes and just really not feeling well. I was like, okay, I probably need to go talk to the GP. So I went to the GP and basically said, you know, I'm not having periods. And they were like, you know, essentially they were like, well, there's different options, but it could, one option is it could be premature menopause. And obviously I was 24 by this point, single 24 year old, basically potentially being told that. I mean, I literally walked out the GP and just like burst into tears, rang my mum and was just like, that's it. Now, thankfully for me, I have a lot of medical friends, but I also was working in a hospital at the time and was working in gynecology. So on the Monday morning after this had happened, I think on the Friday, I went in like devastated with hormone results. I was like, can someone help me? Like, I just, am I in like menopause at 24? Which, you know, it does happen.
Yeah.
Rare, but does happen. And we didn't have it in our family history or anything like that. Anyway, after more testing, they were like, you're not. You've just got hypothalamic amenorrhea. So just, you're not having periods. Basically, my estrogen levels were so low, they were actually undetectable on blood tests.
Wow.
Yeah, you can actually have something that's like, they're like, undetectable. And basically, it's a body's protection. So they were like, your body's in a stressed state. So your body doesn't want to get pregnant right now because it just feels like you would not cope.
So all of your life changes have sort of led your body to go,
Yeah, to shut down and to be like, actually, this is not the time that you would want to get pregnant, therefore, we're going to stop you possibly ovulating, so you won't have periods and you have no...
How clever.
Very clever. but then I had very menopausal symptoms, so I had like night sweats and it was not a pleasant. I really have had an insight into the menopause and I was like, wow, that's really, really, really difficult. So I went through a variety of treatments. I was on the HRT that menopausal women would have, because essentially at 24 you have no estrogen. There's a massive impact on a number of things, including bone health.
Yeah.
So they're like, we've really got to get your estrogen levels up artificially. So I tried that. I had a really bad response to progesterone. So same, I had like terrible migraines, like losing vision in an eye. I remember being with a patient and I was like, I can't see out my left eye. And of course, my medical brain was like, you're having a stroke.
I hate to be in your brain sometimes. You know too much.
So stressful. Anyway, work were amazing. They were like, right, let's just lie down, let's just see. And took some paracetamol and actually managed to make it pass. But that was a repeated cycle. So they had to play around with different things. I went on different pills, you know, just like contraceptive pills, because that could kind of artificially replace it. But essentially really struggled for a number of years. In the end, I met
my husband. So you didn't have a period for years?
So I had them, but they were kind of artificially created. So it's sort of like how you're on your, if you're on a pill, you have kind of these periods, but then it wasn't my body naturally doing it. And I did try and come off at different times. We did a blood test again, and the estrogen levels were still undetectable. So really unideal. So then I met my husband. I mean, we've known each other for years, but we sort of re-met when we were 26. So it'd been a good, like, couple of years that it had all been going on. And we got married a couple of years later. So a bit, essentially, I was on this sort of treatment for about 4 or 5 years.
And did you
have
to say to him, look, I don't know what's going to happen because I think I'm going into early menopause?
Totally. Thankfully, though, by that point, we'd totally established it wasn't that. Because everything else, they were like, your egg reserves is great. Like, everything's in the right place. It's just they don't want to come out.
Right.
The eggs don't want to come out. They don't want to come and have a party. So they were like, pretty much that, like, if you guys want to have children, we kind of recommend that you start trying and see what happens. You know, once we were married, just that's what we decided, and you know, see how it kind of goes. But I'd had a blood test like a month before we got married, which was like undetectable estrogen, and I'd had enough, so I was like, I'm just gonna give my body a break, like, let's have a few months off or yeah. any treatment and just see what happens. And then we got pregnant on our honeymoon.
Miracle.
I genuinely didn't believe it. Like, it was my husband who is medical and was like, do you think, because I had periods, so I was like, I have no idea. It's not like,
so what were the symptoms that you kind
of... Gosh, I think I was awful to live with.
He's like, who did I marry?
Yeah, it's like terrifying. I was really emotional, like classic, like my breasts were really tender, but I thought, oh, maybe I'm going to have a period again, because the symptoms are
similar. Yeah, they are.
So obviously, my body had been all over the place for years, so I just didn't have a real sense of my own rhythm. He's like, let's just do a test, because obviously it's possible. And I was so angry with him. I was like, don't say that. Like, I've emotionally got to a place where I was like, I know this is going to be a real struggle, so I don't really want you saying that to me, because actually I've made a peace in myself that having children could be a really difficult time. And we'd come to that peace as a couple. You know, we knew that we were probably in the long haul, that it was going to be difficult one way or another. We'd have to have help, whatever that might be, or we might adopt. So we kind of got to that place. So it was a real mind shift. Obviously, we were beyond delighted, but it was a real shock to me.
And how far along were you when you did the test?
I must have been, maybe I was a couple of months. Because
really?
Yeah, because I just didn't have any other clues as to why.
How interesting.
So then
you fell pregnant. And were you then worried that you didn't have the right hormones? And
No, because my body just kicked in. And then basically, since I had my daughter back in 2017... My periods came back at month 5, and they have been like regular on the dot ever since.
Wow, so maybe it just needed a kickstart.
Yeah, it just needed to be pregnant. But how? I mean, how?
And you
so
hear
many
a lot
questions.
Of people not even having a period and getting pregnant.
So absolutely.
It's so nice. I mean, I'm sure it's so comforting for people watching to think it can happen, whether you're not regular or whether you haven't had a baby in a long time. Also, be careful, if you don't want to have a baby, it doesn't mean that you're completely protected if you don't.
And they'd always said that to us. They're like, you know, even if you're on these other treatments and you're not having estrogen, you could still get pregnant. But I think I just didn't really believe it. So anyway, so that was amazing. And then...
And then she trained with me.
I did.
I know that she was very calm. You felt very chilled.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. I think because it was the most hormonally stable I'd almost been in like 5 years. And my body was like, this is
the opposite to everyone else. I remember you, because Claire does this for a job, you know what's happening in your body. So she would come to me and tell me things that were going on that I thought, no one else would ever know this, but it's amazing.
I remember having a really sore belly button quite a lot, didn't I? And I was like, oh, I'm so worried about my tummy. And but essentially, it was just a normal thing. But I think living it as a women's health physio was
I was
really
going to say, has it given you a different insight to working with your
massively.
Women that you see every day?
Yeah, I think I had all the cognitive knowledge, but I think living it, your empathy levels are like through the roof.
Yeah.
I think my practice has slightly changed in kind of what it probably gives to women to do, because I just know now as a mum like how I fit stuff in.
5 exercises a day.
Yeah.
Like, they won't do it.
That's not going to happen. I don't do my own rehab exercises at 5 days. I literally can do one thing a day. So that has really changed. I think I found the preparation of birth very difficult, because essentially a lot of what I do is the complicated postpartum.
Yeah, you don't
time.
Usually see just normal.
Yeah, most people don't come and be like, I've got absolutely no problem. can you help me?
Yeah.
It's more like, oh, I'm incontinent or.
Yeah,
you know, sex
so you
is
just
painful.
See the worst.
Yeah, and so I did really struggle, and I had like weird nightmares and dreams about birth actually in the pregnancy. And I thankfully knew the mental health midwife at the hospital I was delivering. So I was just like, can I come for a chat? Because I'm aware this is actually really affecting me mentally. Who was amazing and linked me in. Lots of trusts actually have things called consultant midwives, which I think lots of people don't know about.
So if you're feeling like this, do you just go and talk to
talk to your midwife and
then refer
and just, you know, if you're someone who's like, I just cannot imagine having a vaginal birth, and that's pretty much the point I'd got to. I was like, I think I'm just going to go for a C-section. But in my heart of hearts, I did want to try for a vaginal birth.
And I think that's really interesting. You know, you see it all and you still wanted to go for it, which makes me think, it can't be always that bad, you know? Like,
and I had a lovely birth, you know, I really, really did. And I think positive vaginal birth stories don't exist that much. It's hard, I think, because once you've had one, you don't want to be that person who's like, well, actually, I had a lovely vaginal birth.
No, I know, because you think everyone's like, going to hate you.
Yeah.
But actually, people
women need to hear
haven't
it.
Had a baby yet, that's really good to hear, because, you know, like you said, people love to shout about their horror
problems.
Stories.
Yeah. And they're valid as well, but it's just hard, I think, because isn't always not necessarily a balance of the two. And I did do everything I possibly could. I personally did hypnobirthing classes. I did perineal massage. I used something called the Epino, which is like a little balloon device that you can use to kind of stretch your pelvic floor. So I really was like, I'm going into this. I'm doing everything
doing
I
it all.
Possibly can. And I'm not saying I did have a few stitches. I had to work at my pelvic floor. Like, it's not part of the job description when you get a pelvic floor.
You didn't come
floor.
Back to training with me for a while.
No, exactly.
And I remember just thinking, that's really nice to see that you just do what you say to other people to do.
It took my time. And I did lose my confidence in my body a bit, because it's not like I had raging incontinence or anything like that, but there were just so many changes. And I felt just like, one, I was a bit all over the place. You know, I was trying to learn how to breastfeed, and I mean,
it's not like you're just sat on the sofa doing nothing, is it?
Definitely not. And I was exhausted. And so I really properly probably said I didn't train properly for like 6 months or so.
Yeah.
But was I idle? No. But I just didn't, you know, I didn't train in the same way.
Go back to the gym and train. Yeah,
I couldn't fit it into my schedule with my husband's work schedule as well. It just didn't work for us.
Yeah.
And in the evenings, I had no interest in going near a gym. So it was just the only time I probably could have gone, I was too tired. So I just kind of did a lot of like individual Pilates kind of focused stuff at home. I didn't put too much pressure on myself, but
yourself a bit slack.
Yeah, but this pregnancy I've had to really watch myself, because I did have some pelvic pain last time.
Yeah.
Which I was able to manage with physiotherapy and kind of working out really helped it, because it was keeping myself strong. But this time, kind of going into it, I knew that I needed to keep strong. So from really early on, I really worked on glutes. But I don't mean like I've been training 3 times a week at the gym, because most weeks it doesn't work like that for us.
Especially now you've got
I've got a toddler and I work, my husband's work, you know, we're constantly juggling, you know, weekends you generally have plans and stuff. So I do what I can, but a lot of the time it's just been, she now knows that we do our squats and she has a little resistance band.
So
she tries to do crabbles but keeps falling down. She's like,
she can't lift her legs as wide.
Yeah. They're not wide enough. So, you know, we work out together, work out. I mean, it's not like I get particularly sweaty, but my glutes get a workout, my core gets a workout. Yeah, and I've just had to focus on that. And yes, have I put on weight? Yes. Have I got more cellulite? Absolutely yes. Does that bother me some days? Yes. But it is my reality right now, and I'm doing what I feel I need to keep my body strong for motherhood, prepare myself for another birth, because ultimately that's what's coming up at the end of the year.
Well, that's what you're working for, so...
Totally.
You need to change your mindset and say,
completely.
Why am I training? It's not for the cellulite, it's for the birth. And,
exactly.
You don't know what's going to happen, no one knows. So you need to sort of put yourself in the best possible situation to deal with that.
And that's why I love training with you, because it was kind of just like, right, what muscle groups do we need to be strong?
Yeah.
And I actually delivered basically in a squatting sort of position.
Exactly, so all those squat holds that she hated.
They really paid off.
That's how you did them.
And midwives are always really impressed, aren't they? They're like, wow, I mean, they were like, you really... was strong in this labor.
Because there's no point in me training clients to do really isolated just bicep curls, you know what I mean? Because you do need to use your bicep curls, but holding a baby whilst walking, so let's hold something and do some lunges, you know, like
functional.
Exactly.
Totally.
And so emotionally, how have you felt becoming pregnant this time? Because it happened for you fairly easily.
Easily again this time. Yeah. Again, I think I got in this head, well, that was so easy, so this time's going to be really hard. And it's hard to say it, because I'd have a lot of friends who are having a really difficult time of fertility. Yeah. And but for whatever reason, we've been really blessed to fall pregnant
and
again.
And you shouldn't feel ashamed of that. It's amazing.
It is amazing, it's been a real gift. I've been a lot more sick this time, and I did emotively find this first trimester a lot harder. I think because the demands on you, like you're still going to work and performing, but then you come home and you've got a little person who needs you to be mummy. There's no time for you to feel unwell. But I think then I had no energy for anyone else. And I'm a real extrovert, so I found it quite isolating. And I'm not good at spending days in bed, but some days I just had to take the day out and spend it in bed, because I just had nothing in me and nothing to give.
You need to pick who you give your energy to, because there's not a lot of it.
There's not a lot of it, and my 2-year-old needs
and
a
your
lot
friends
of it.
And your family will understand.
They do get it. And I was much more open this time about being pregnant. I told work a lot earlier, I told friends a lot earlier. I think I just was like, I've got to be real about this, because this is hard, you know, I found
actually,
it a lot harder.
Why are you keeping it a secret? You need the help. If anything were to happen, you'd need the
I'd
support.
I'd share it, exactly.
So actually, I think it makes sense to tell the people that you see most days.
I couldn't hide it either. I mean, people were like, you're barely talking. And I was like, great. I was like, I'm just conserving all energy that I possibly can. So it was challenging, but again, it all these things, like, I've always forgotten it now, even though it wasn't that far away. You know, you think, oh, I'd never do this again. And you're like, well, I could.
Yeah.
It wasn't that bad.
You've got through it. Otherwise, no one would ever have more than one child, ever.
I know. So yeah, it's definitely been it's been different. But, you know, second trimester, a lot more energy and enjoying.
And are you going to do things like hypnobirthing that you did last time?
Yeah, so I'm going to go for a hypnobirthing refresh. I'm reading a couple of books again just to get my head back into it. We're actually aiming at home birth this time.
Amazing.
Which, yeah, some people will be like, you're mental, but actually for
me... Well, if your first birth was
I basically went into hospital and they... Not they didn't give me anything, but I didn't actually have any painkillers from them. So it was actually my husband was like, you were so zen at home. I found the transition into hospital personally
quite stressful
because I was in this zone and then suddenly like, I've got to get in the car and I've got to get in the lift and I've got to get up to the third floor.
And the lights are bright.
Yeah, and then you're like, oh, this is a midwife I've never met. Okay, right, now we've got to like do this. And I found that transition really hard.
Yeah.
Whereas actually I found being at home and being in labour, I mean, I'd never ever say to any woman that it was easy because that would be lying. But I felt like I could really manage it. And so we decided, and it was quite quick the first time, so we just decided that we're going to aim for home. Obviously, the hospital we can go to is just up the road. We can transition if we need to. But, so...
Well, you're going to have to come back and tell us how it was.
I know. Yes, I will.
I'm looking forward to hearing that about the home births. I've had a lot of good home birth stories recently.
Yeah, and I think so much more positive stories are coming out, aren't they? And actually, what the research says now is, like, it's number two... Or more,
and if number one was fine,
as uncomplicated,
then,
it's a very safe thing to do.
Ivana be in the house, or what's
I'm still working this out. I mean, I've asked lots of people's advice, and they say that if they're asleep upstairs, because lots of babies are born overnight, like she was born overnight, you just leave her asleep, and then you just wake up in the morning, and there's another baby.
Have some breakfast. Yeah. Oh, by the way,
this happened overnight. So I'm still kind of getting my head around that. I mean, we're really fortunate; our families are very close by, so I may get my parents to come and be upstairs. They can sleep in our room because we're going to just be downstairs in our kind of living dining area.
Oh my gosh, they're not going to be able to sleep. Imagine.
I know.
Oh, she's just having a baby.
Just having a casual baby downstairs.
Wow.
But then I feel like mentally, I'm like, if she did wake up or something woke her up,
she's not going to come down and see.
No, and she's, you know, she's got someone, and if they need to whisk her off, they can take her off to their house, which is like 15 minutes away. So I'm still working that out in my head. I haven't quite got that because that was a whole like, it's so different with the number two. But yeah, that's the general gist.
That's the plan.
And I'm due around Christmas time, so I mean,
maybe
we'll
be
like
so
in turkey
great.
And stuffing and
yeah, you have a baby and then pass me the celebration.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, yes, well, yeah, come back, tell us all about that. And I'm so glad you don't feel sick and horrible.
I know.
She's glowing.
Me too.
She's glowing.
I love this bit of pregnancy.
Okay. Well, good luck.
Thank you.
And we'll speak to you soon.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.